There we go. Some people asked me if I'd record this, so see if I can get myself situated here. Hi, my name's Dana Cadman. If I haven't met you yet, or if you don't meet, I am your Director of Communications, and I do want to emphasize your. I work at the Office of the General Assembly. I oversee the communications of that office, which includes all of our internet presence. I help coordinate print publications. But one of the things I love doing is helping resource all of you. And at the end of this presentation, I'm going to show you that there are some resources that we have available for you after General Assembly, and excited about sharing those with you. In putting this presentation together, the title here, Big Communications for Small Churches with Little Hassles. By that, I don't mean that small churches have little hassles, because sometimes your hassles are big. But what I'm going to try to do is take some of the hassle out of the work that you do in the area of church communications. What we'll be talking about today is volunteers' websites and print publications, particularly bulletins and newsletters. In some of the work that I do at the office, once a month I do a free webinar for our churches on the topic of church communications. So these are some of the topics that I've been requested to repeat or do in more depth. And usually when somebody calls up with a question, it's usually one of these things that I get questions about. I get lots of questions, but these are the most popular, so that's why I chose these topics. By the way, show of hands, can you folks hear me in the back there? Okay, yeah. I don't usually have problem being heard. What I do have problem is shouting down the people in the front row. So if at any time I'm just way too loud or if I start spitting, I don't usually do that, but if I do, just let me know and I'll change direction or something. So the first things I want to talk about is volunteers. And by the way, show of hands, how many of you, okay, when I talk about church communications, I'm talking about internal and external communications, the way that you reach out to your community and the way that you communicate information to the members, you know, in your congregation. So given that definition, how many of you are the sole communicator for your church or organization? We've got, okay, a few here. So the rest of you work in some kind of team then, either part-time or you coordinate volunteers. Is that a good assessment here? Did I miss anybody? Okay. So regardless though of your situation, many hands do make light work. And so the more volunteers we get, the better we are off for two reasons. For number one, for those of you who are working by yourself, it can be very daunting at times. Sometimes you come up with a challenge that skill-wise or time-wise is beyond you, and it'd be great to have someone who could come alongside and help out. For those of you who are already in a team situation, and maybe you've experienced this, one of the great things about inviting more people to join your team is that you're giving more people the opportunity to use the skills and the passion that God has given them. So never think that you have enough people on your team. Maybe you do, and if you have enough people on your team, I would love to talk to you afterward about that, because I've not run into that situation. Everybody's always looking for more help, either in terms of just more capacity or more capability, and I'll be talking about that too. But you know, just remember that in asking for volunteers, you are getting someone to help you, but you're also giving somebody an opportunity to do the things that God intended them to, and that is a great mentoring opportunity, one that I enjoy in roles I've had in the past. There are two approaches that we can take to recruiting volunteers, and a lot of this is dependent both on your availability of time and also your personality. The two that I'm talking about are recruiting and mentoring. Recruiting typically is a great way to bring in volunteers if you are more of an extroverted person. You like being in groups. You like the excitement of other people around. Mentoring, though, is a great approach if you're more of an introvert. You enjoy more of a deeper rather than broader connection to people. And I'm not saying that these two are mutually exclusive. There are times in your role when it's good to be able to transfer back and forth between the two depending upon your situation. But just I wanted you to be aware, think about your own personality, how you like to interact with people. And that'll help direct you in the kind of approach you take in recruiting volunteers. Now, looking at recruiting, some advantages and disadvantages. When you recruit a large group of people, number one, you get a lot of hands on deck fast, and that's great because now it's easy to divide up the work into smaller pieces that are maybe easier to manage, and so you get more traction going on things that you want to do. Recruiting also typically pools a broad range of skills. That doesn't always happen. There may be an instance where you ask, hey, we're forming a communications team or we're growing it. Would you like to join us? You get six people joining. Five of them are graphic artists. Okay, well, you were looking maybe for something a little more diverse than that. What that means is that now as the leader of this communications team, you've got to be figure out how to become a visually communicating church because that's the talent pool you have on hand. So, you work with what, God has provided you. And also, one of the things I like about large teams is that more minds makes more opportunities for brainstorming. And I'm going to throw a little bit of math at you. I've read this great article talking about communications and why communications breakdowns as organizations grow. This author, who is a behavioral scientist, put down this formula, n squared minus n all divided by 2. That is the number of communication paths in any organization. So by way of an example, if you have 6 people, n squared is 36, minus 6 is 30, divided by 2 is 15. There are 15 paths of communication on your team of 6 people. And if you play with the numbers a little bit, you'll see just by adding 2 more people, the number of communications paths grows, exponentially. But the great thing about having all these communication paths, these are the connections in your team. And the more connections you have, the more brainstorming opportunities you have. The more opportunities for 2 or 3 people to get together and say, hey, I read this article. What do you think about this? Next thing you know, they've come up with this great new way for you to communicate information from your church. So that's one of the great things about building a larger team. Now, the disadvantages, though, is that with a large team, you have to put some work on hold while you organize your team. Because you can't just go to each person and give them a task. What you're doing is managing a bunch of individuals. You're not actually managing a team. So you do need to take some time to coordinate those efforts. You need to take some time in building some team relationships so you can have some of that great brainstorming going on. And then that goes to the next bullet point, requires, some scheduling and coordination. And unfortunately, when you add more people, now you not only get more brainstorming, you get more disagreements of opinion. And sometimes that requires some mediation on your part. So anyway, just some things to point out in building large teams. There are some advantages and disadvantages to that. And I'm sorry, I should have said at the beginning here, if you have questions, go ahead, raise your hand. If I don't see you, shoot off a flare pistol or something. But if you've got questions at any time, just let me know and I'll take care of them then. But there will be time at the end for Q&A and also some time for us to be talking to each other. In mentoring, as you can imagine, a lot of the advantages of recruiting become disadvantages and vice versa. In mentoring, it's easier to combine work and training. I don't now have to sit down with my team and provide them training. I can have someone sit with me and watch me work and explain to them what I'm doing so that I can transfer that knowledge to them. Now, when you have someone, watching over your shoulder, yeah, it does slow down your work, but you don't have to separate work and training. Work and training become the same thing. So that's what, one of the nice things about mentoring. You also have fewer scheduling conflicts because it's one more person. When are you going to get together? You don't have to try to, coordinate the schedule of, 6 or 8 people on your team. And you get a stronger relationship because you've got more of that one-on-one time. So that's one of the great things of mentoring. The downside, though, with mentoring is that it builds capacity and capability more slowly. Since you're only growing your team by one person, that's your capacity. You can only add as much work as you can add for one person. Capability, you've got whatever skill that person brings with them or skills that they bring with them versus the skills of a larger team. So if you were looking to maybe start doing video in your communications, but this person brings a strong writing and editing background, you're going to have to hold off on that video capability. You may be able to sit down and write some great scripts together, but you won't be able to film anything until you get those videography skills into your communications team. And you do get fewer new ideas because you've got fewer people generating those new ideas, fewer people reading articles, attending seminars, finding new information from different sources. Let's Let's see. Page down. There we go. Now, in terms of finding volunteers, before we start putting out a call to our congregation or the ministry that we're working in and asking for volunteers, the last thing you want to do is put out a generic plea. Hi, we're putting together a communications team and we need volunteers. People don't know often what a communication teams mean. They might have a different mindset than you do, and therefore you may get people coming who are going to be disappointed because your ministry isn't going to be what they were expecting. By the same token, there may be people who, because they have a different definition, don't show up. So instead of saying, you know, hey, we're forming a communications team, instead, you know, put out specific skills that you're looking for. We're looking for writers. We're looking for graphic artists. We're looking for people who really get technology. You know, these kinds of things. You know, let people know what it is that you're looking for. In putting together your list of volunteers that you would like to recruit, you need to prioritize what are the things that you're trying to do. And then after you list what things you want to do, what activities you want to do in your communications team, then start listing the skills that go with those activities. And you'll find out that, you know, some of the activities have overlapping skills. So what you'll do is go from a list of activities to a list of skills, and that'll tell you the kind of volunteers that you're looking for. And that's how you ask for volunteers to help with the, you know, those specific skills. And I'll show this on a chart next, but what we're going to do is a skill gap analysis then, where on one side of the page you list the skills that you're looking for, and on the next side you have a list of the skills that volunteers are bringing to you. That will identify where you need to continue to recruit volunteers. It'll also help you show where you might have some training opportunities, that you can take a volunteer that you have and grow them into a role that they're not quite ready for yet. And then also, like I mentioned, be willing to revise the plan based on the talent pool you get. Again, if you're looking for one set of skills and you get a whole bunch of other set of skills, then that's an opportunity for you to talk to your volunteers and also, you know, to go to God and say, okay, this is what you gave me. What do I need to do with this that I hadn't imagined before? Because obviously you have something different planned than what I envisioned. So, you know, don't forget to include God in all that we do. And sometimes when you get down in the weeds, it's difficult to remember that. So here's what I was talking about. Here's a list of the things that, you know, as a church we might want to do. We've got our Sunday bulletin that's got to come out every week. We've got a couple ministries that have newsletters. We need to, you know, bring those up to speed, because what they're doing, you know, is taking too long. It doesn't really communicate very well. We don't have a website, and we need one, and people are talking about this Facebook thing. Maybe we should investigate that. So here's all the activities that we want to do. And then on the left here, we have, well, here, let me back up a slide a minute. So down below each activity, I've listed the skills that go with that activity. So on the next page, I've combined all the skills. So that's what's on the left. And on the right is just a hypothetical list of skills that the volunteers are bringing in. So as you can see, we've got someone who's very talented in Microsoft Word. They can format things very quickly, but they're not the writer we were hoping to get. So that means we still need to find a writer. Our website seems to be going in the right direction. We've got all the skills we need for that. We don't have a Facebook person, but we do have someone who likes to use Twitter and blog. Now what we need to do is go to that person and ask them, would you be willing, since you're already doing some social media stuff, could you maybe learn Facebook for us? Would you be willing to look at that? And they might say, you know, great, you know, excited to, or they might say, I tried Facebook, don't like it, that's why I'm doing this other stuff. In which case, again, you're still looking for another volunteer. But it's getting to the skill gap analysis that helps you figure out, again, training opportunities and additional resources you need to recruit. So, any quick questions on volunteers, or I'll go on to the next topic? Okay, so let's look at websites. And some of this might be basic for, how many of you already have a website? Okay, let's change that. Does anybody here not have a website yet? Okay, all right, we've got a few. Okay, so for some of you, this might be review, but I tried to design this so there'd be some tips in here for people at all experience levels. But looking at websites, the basics you need for any website, first off, you need to register a domain name, which many people think is their website address. That's not quite close, or not accurate, but close enough. But you need to register a domain name somewhere. You need to find a place to host your website. You need to design what your website's going to look like. You need to create some content for it. And one thing I'd like to point out is that no internet presence is better than a bad internet presence. I mean, all of us have been to a website somewhere and you go, who designed that? You know, you want to think it was the neighbor's kid, but the neighbor's kid probably would do a really good job with designing a website. So it was probably the neighborhood kid's parents who ended up doing it. But, you know, you see the spinning logo, you see really small text that's hard to read, their color contrast where it makes the text difficult to read. You know, and I'll talk a little bit more about design later. But that's important. And then, of course, having good content. If you know, you can have the best looking website in the world, and I've seen some really great looking websites, but when I get there, it's kind of like going to some place and, you know, the food looks great and you get there and then you find out there's nothing on the menu you want to order. You'll end up leaving hungry. You can have the most dullest looking website. I'm not saying a bad one, but you can have just a plain website with text. If the content is really, really good, people won't care that your website looks plain and boring. They're coming back for the content. So now I'm jumping ahead of myself here, but anyway, just some reasons why you want to make sure that when you plan out your website, you have all of these pieces together and in the right place before you get this thing launched. Just a quick thing on domain registration. If you haven't already registered a site or if you're looking to switch your domain registrar, I highly recommend DomainMonger or NameSecure. Now, I've only used NameSecure a little bit. I've read quite a few reviews. It's very highly regarded. It's won some awards. I've been using DomainMonger for 14 years, and I can tell you, DomainMonger, even though they don't have a phone number you can call, you contact them only through email, their response rate is just awesome. I contact them with a low priority request, and the worst response I ever had was 18 hours. And when I have a high priority, something gone horribly wrong, I got to get fixed, the worst situation I was ever in was 90 minutes, and they usually have it solved in 40 minutes or less. Almost every time I send them a ticket, I ask, when are you going public? I want stock in you. So I can't say enough good things about DomainMonger. Again, if you haven't registered yet, I highly recommend do not go with GoDaddy or Network Solutions for a variety of reasons. I won't go into detail, but just two that I would recommend staying away from. And then also make sure you get a .org domain name just to help recognize your nonprofit status.
So can I ask if those are technological issues with them or ethical issues with them?
Yes. So, you know, okay. As long as the cat's coming out of the bag, particularly one of the problems I have with both of these. If you are transferring a domain to them, they are more than happy to take your money and bend over backward to make sure that transfer happens just the best way possible. But if you try to transfer a domain away from them, you are in for a week of hurt. And emphasis there on week. They just make, I have transferred domains from probably a half dozen different registrars, and I never have problems the way I have with these two. So, anyway.
What's your annual cost on DomainMonger?
DomainMonger starts at $17 a year, but as you purchase multiple years, the cost goes down per year. I think their absolute cheapest plan is $11 a year. I usually buy the five-year registration, so it costs me $13 a year for each of the 5 years. So DomainMonger does cost like maybe a dollar more per year than some of these others. But for the dollar extra a year, they're so absolutely worth it.
What do you think about parking domains so that you control all the other associated names around that?
Okay, by parking domains, what you're talking about is, let's say you are just picking a popular name in our denomination. Let's say you're firstpres.org, okay? And we're talking about parking firstpres.com, firstpres.net, firstpres.tv, all these others.
Does DomainMonger give you a break if you try to do that with them?
No, they don't give you a break if you purchase multiple.
Full $17 on each of those guys.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, for a branded business, that might make sense. But for churches, especially, like I said, in our denomination, First Presbyterian, you know, bulletins.org. Somebody grab that. The rest of you are just going to have to come up with some variation on it. Sorry. But yeah, I'm very much about getting the .org top-level domain as much as possible. Now, if you've been reading in some of the tech journals, you may see that there's next year ICANN, which is the International Council Assigning Network Names, is coming up with some new domain extensions next year. One of them that hasn't been approved but is being floated around is .church. I have not been able to find out how much that will cost, because these new domains will cost more. 10 or 15 years from now, maybe they'll be the same cost as everything else, but initially they're going to cost more. Should you have .church? You know, there was a time when your domain name figured very significantly in how your search engine rankings occurred, but as time has gone on, the search engines have figured out some of the places that have had websites for 20 years are far less relevant than some of the places that have websites for 20 weeks, and you know, the domain name really doesn't give us an idea just how relevant these websites are. So, I don't, you know, if you want to get that .church, go for it. You know, that could be great for you, but I'm not pressing it as something we should all rush out and do. Question? Yep.
Yeah, back when we got ours, because of the search engine stuff, they had the people we were using had us get a .com rather than a .org. Is there a strong pressing thing that we should try to move that to a .org rather than have it be .com?
The question is, should you, church has a .com top-level domain, should we switch it to a .org? My answer to that is yes, but you don't have to do it right away. It shouldn't be a pressing issue. At some point, maybe as you're looking to redesign your site, or if you're going to go through a major rebranding in your church, that would be a good time to look at it. But most likely people are looking at your website because they already know your church and they're coming there to get information about an organization they're already somewhat familiar with. Now, there are people who are coming to your website to check you out because they're trying to figure out where to go to church on Sunday. They may question the .com, why is this nonprofit using a commercial top-level domain? And some people, especially younger audiences, do have that question because they're more savvy on what that .com and .org means. As long as the content of your website is both broad in the audiences that it reaches, teens, singles, young marrieds, seasoned citizens, as long as it really portrays a strong brand message about who you are in your community, the .com doesn't mean as much. At some point, like I said, when it's convenient for you, I would switch it over. Just because you never know where ICANN or the U.S. Congress is going to go with some of these domains and how they're managed.
Another thing to consider, though, would be your email.
Exactly. A good point. Yeah, another thing to consider is that these domain names affect not only your website, but they also affect your email address.
Yeah.
And if, in your email, you don't get to convey all that wonderful text that's on your website. So certainly for email correspondence, that's where the .org would really make more traction. Thank you for bringing that up.
Well, so, if you're already committed to a .com, though, and your emails also are using that.
Yeah.
.com, then you get that all that maintenance work to also take care
of. Exactly. So you not only have to get a new domain and move over the content and communicate it to everybody, but then everybody that you send emails to, you've got to say, hey, next month we're changing our address. This will be my new email address. And for a period of time, I recommend maintaining both, and probably for a period of at least 6 months, if not a year, maintaining both domains, just so that as an email comes in, you can say, hey, by the way, my email address is really over here now. Other questions? Okay. Now, in terms of hosting, if you are hosting your website at your church facility, then what you need is a lot of redundancy there to make sure that if something happens to your facility or your server, that people can still have access to your website. Just in the last year, we've had churches hit by lightning. They've been flooded. They've been destroyed by tornadoes. And imagine that, you know, along with your building, your website also goes with that. So I highly recommend that unless you can establish some very redundant backups, that you probably want to host your website somewhere other than where your church physically meets. There are a lot of great hosting services out there. One of them, P3i Systems. I've not worked with them, but I have worked with Rob Mitchell, who's one of our ruling elders. I worked with him on the Christian Education and Publications Committee for 2 years. Rob is a super guy. He's also a very detailed guy. And if his company's run anything like he is, then, P3SI Systems would be a great place to host your website. And if you mention you're from the EPC, if you mention my name, you know, he'll probably give you a discount. Mention you're with the EPC. I don't know about my name or not. But one thing I do want to mention, if you're already using a template site or if you're considering going to a template site, please don't. By a template site, what I mean is that there are services out there where for a small fee, like $200, you get a website, and you get to pick from one of 100 different designs. You get to cut and paste your text from Word into their website, and it creates a web page for you, and you tell it which page is linked to which, and it sounds really super. The problem with these template sites, though, and there could be some good ones out there, but my vast experience with them is they suck you in with a low price, like $200 for a website, which is really cheap, and then they charge you $40 or $50 a month for hosting. Well, you start adding that up, $50 a month, now you're paying $600 a year for this site. And the other disadvantage of template sites is that, let's say you decide you want to go somewhere else, you don't get to take the template with you because the company owns the template. So you can take off your pictures and you can take off your text, but you're going to have to rebuild your site. You've got nothing you can transport. So again, just beware of template sites with low entry prices. And, you know, if you are looking at a template site, look and see what their monthly hosting fee is. It should never be anything more than $19.99 a month. And you can find some that are $17.99 or maybe even $12.99. But yeah, $50 a month, that's a bad investment. Yes?
There are some sites that will also host for free nonprofits if you can verify that it is with the proper tax documents, that you are a nonprofit organization.
Oh, okay. Now, any of the sites I'm aware of that do that, also you have to put some banner advertising on your site? Are you aware of ones that don't?
This particular one, we don't have to do banner ads. I can't recall the name at the moment.
Okay, all right. Well, that's good. Okay, like I said, my experience has been that the sites that will host you for free include banner advertising, but you're saying that there's at least one that doesn't. So
if you can verify that you're a nonprofit.
Yeah, with the proper tax documents and verify. Okay. Well, that's good to know. Okay. So that'd be worth doing some searching. Just a moment, we got a question in the back there. Yeah.
For micro cathedral churches like ours, where the pastor is the master and doesn't know anything, are we better off trying to find a hosting site that has, quote, the tools, what you see is what you get type of thing, where you can plug in stuff that you need? Or is there a separate program that will help us design a website to upload? Because most of those online tools don't work real well.
All right, great question. Should we use the online tools that some sites provide, or should we use a program and design it our own and upload it? I think you're leading right into my next slide here.
Just like we rehearsed.
Yes, exactly. Good job. I'll get you your $5 later.
But before you go there,
before you go there.
Another question.
Yeah.
Do you know how much storage capacity and so forth that Bob's selling on his systems? That is a big issue. You have to know the capacity you need.
Yes. Yeah. When you're looking for hosting, you do need to know the capacity. I don't know. I didn't look into that detail. My guess is he probably offers a gigabyte of storage, which is pretty typical. Because in our conversation, he made mention that, you know, we offer a package similar to what others do. And usually that's what I see with hosting companies. They offer 1 or 2 gigabytes of storage, which for your HTML text pages, which are very small, for any graphics you're going to upload, a gigabyte is more than enough storage. You're not going to start chewing that up unless you start putting video and audio files on your website. And then you can see your storage space disappear very quickly. But for your typical websites, even if your site had 100 pages with one picture on each page, you'd be hard-pressed to come close to a gigabyte, I think. So, all right, now we're...
Before you flip your page?
Before, okay, one more, yes.
We're on a template site for nothing through the American Bible Society.
The American Bible Society offers...
They do. And then for like $15, the name you got to use about is monstrous. For $15 a year, they'll shrink it to, we'll customize it to your particular location. So for $15 a year, we have a several page website through the American Bible Society.
Okay. See, that's why I love doing these seminars, because believe it or not, I don't know everything. So, as being evidence that, and I'm knowing less as you bring up these ideas. So, I'm getting stupider. Okay, no, that's.
I didn't know it was called a template site.
Okay.
Okay. That's what it is.
Okay, American Bible Society. So that could be a good entry point. Now, I'd be interested to look at that, because to see. Again, if it's a template site, then if you need to go somewhere else, you won't be able to take the content with you if it's a true template site. But on the other hand, if you're just getting into this, that might be a good place to start until you figure out what you really do want to do with your website. So, and again, I should say, in building websites, you don't have to start big. I mean, plan big. You may sit down with your team and figure out, what we really need is going to be a 62-page website, because you've got it all planned out what all the content is. You don't have to build all 62 pages at once. Build the core 8 pages that you really need, and as time permits, then start adding on pieces here and there. As I explained it to clients back when I had my own business, building a website is a lot like building a house. Now, if you know you want a 3,000 square foot house, but you can only afford 1,500 feet now, it is a lot easier to design that house at the beginning, knowing that you're going to add that additional footage. You know where to put things to make that addition easier, rather than buying a 1,500 square foot house and 2 years going, oh, we'd like to add another 1,500 square feet, but man, how are we going to move these walls around, kind of thing. So, plan for 5 years down the road, but build for today. Can I go to the next slide now?
Sure.
Okay, all right, everyone's in agreement, good, okay. So looking at design, okay, the question we had in the back there, using tools or that are online versus using tools, building something and uploading it. The slide here says, volunteers offers are great, but they come with a lot of downfalls. And unfortunately, when you've got volunteers to work with, maybe that's what you have to work with. But when you have volunteers offer to build your website, first off, it is slow, and I know because I've volunteered to do that, and life interrupts. I have a day job, I have a family. You get a volunteer, they may build something for you, and then job makes, they have to move in a year for some reason, or they're expecting a child, and all of a sudden they're busy and can't get to these things. So even if they get the website built in a timely fashion, getting their time to continue updating it and maintaining it can be a real problem. And that's true whether they have a tool on their computer and they upload stuff, or whether this tool is online. The only advantage of being online is that when somebody's using a tool on their computer, let's say they build your website in Fireworks, and 18 months from now they can't maintain the website anymore, but someone else will, but they don't have Fireworks, they have Dreamweaver. Okay, well, you know what happens? We have to redesign the website. Every time I've been in a situation where we're changing tools, along with that comes, we have to redesign the website. That is always the discussion. So, I'm just warning you, this is the pitfall of using volunteers, as well-intentioned as they are. Now, it's okay to get a graphics designer in as a volunteer, because they design your initial site for you. They design how this thing's going to look, and that's a look that could stay with you for 5, 10, maybe even 15 years. Although, at each 5-year mark, you probably want to review, is our design current? Maybe should we update it or maybe completely redo it? I just highly recommend that review every 5 years. Just put it on your calendar or planner right now for that. But But a volunteer graphic designer can save you a lot of money and get your project started very quickly. But when it comes to actually creating the pages and doing the programming, that's where you probably want to go ahead and spend the money to hire a professional to do it for you so they can get it done in a timely fashion. And as long as you pick a good company, pardon me, you can get it done in an efficient and effective way as well. So now a couple of companies that I would recommend, businessies.net. I know the owner of this company. She lives about 10 miles from where I live. I've done several website projects with her. She's really good, and she has a heart for nonprofits, particularly churches. So she'd be a great person to call. Again, now Faith Highway, I have no experience with other than I've looked at their website. I've read some reviews of them. I hear some great things about them. So either one of these would be great resources if you're looking to either build a website or maybe redesign your current one. And certainly, again, you want to look within your own congregation as well. Maybe someone in your company, you know, or in your company within your church, you know, designs websites professionally. Either they work for a company, or maybe they have their own, or maybe they know somebody. So, you know, it's great to work with people who are local because you get those conversations going faster. But the beautiful thing about building a website is that you can be here in Louisiana, the design company can be up in Idaho, this whole thing's being hosted on a server farm in Texas. You don't all have to be together, you just have to be able to talk either through email or phone. So, and that is a comfort zone for some people to get out of, you know, dealing with somebody through the phone rather than somebody they can meet face to face. But I've worked on plenty of projects, you know, by phone, and they've worked almost pretty much as well as projects, you know, face-to-face. So just some thoughts on design there. Now, by way of design, when you're planning out your design, don't get too mired in the details first of how it's going to look, you know, getting the finished graphics and such. It's great if you've got an artist who's very fast and comes up with them, but where I recommend starting out is with these block diagrams so that you get an idea of where are things going to be on the page. Because even without any text or pictures, you've already got a sense of what this web page looks like. Up at the top here, we've got a banner with the church's name, and if they've got a logo, it's up there, and maybe, you know, a sunset or a field of flowers, because churches like to include those things. You know, the navigation menus off on, you know, and I'm not saying that's bad, I'm just, you know. Anyway, and off on the left here, we have our navigation menu. Down here at the bottom, we've got a footer. That's where your phone number, your fax number, and your street address, it's all located. We've got a space here for two headlines, some text. Maybe that's a picture in the upper right-hand corner, but you can see that very quickly, this is what your home page and maybe your interior pages is going to look like. Very quick to put together. And I recommend doing this before you get to those finished graphics, so because the finished graphics tend to distract from how we're going to organize our page. Doing something like this, you know, or another exercise you can do is actually even cut out pieces of different colored paper or just take paper and write things on them and then just move them around on a table. And they might not always be square. You might end up with something hanging out on the edge, and that just means you either need to trim it or make some other pieces wider. But take some pieces and just arrange them around on the table and see what it looks like. Now, you know, and then with this here, I was kind of going with an earth tone thing here. So you got your sky, and then I planned a tree and grass on the bottom, but some people might look at that and go, well, the brown is dirt, so why don't we put the green on the grass over here and put the dirt underneath the grass, so you can flip it around that way. You know, now maybe you're with a, you know, younger, contemporary, edgy church, so you went with the racing colors here, you know, powerful black, white, and red. And so you still have your banner across the top, but your navigation's across the top instead of the side. You've got on the left here a big welcome visitor graphic, and on the right here you've got a rotating set of graphics that, you know, talk about the events coming up. And down at the bottom here you've got, you know, a calendar of events and our pastor blogs, and here's our contact information. So see, it's just very quick. You can just rearrange these things and figure out how you want to put these elements together into a design. And this is a great thing to hand to a graphic artist and say, here's the layout we're thinking of, what can you do with this? And, you know, they may come up with some adjustments, and that's great, but it's a very quick way to get everything organized. In terms of the content, the text, and the pictures that are going to go on your website, again, make sure you know your audience. Who are you speaking to? Is your church more focused on its members? We're going to provide you with stuff, you know, information about events that are going on. Is it more outward focused? Hey, you've never been here. Welcome. Here's who we are about. Here's what we can do for your family. This is how we can introduce you to God. You know, things like that. It is possible, I mean, certainly your website's going to have content for both people who are visitors and people who attend your church, but one audience is going to dominate over the other. And I'm not saying one's worse or better than the other. I'm just saying that's got to be the focus of your church, because if you try to do a website that's for both, you're going to end up with a disappointment for both audiences. Now, that's not to say you can't put information for both audiences, but especially that home page, it's going to appeal to one audience or the other. Now, if you look at the website here for First Presbyterian Church of Baton Rouge, they did something really cool. They have a welcome message along the left side of the page, and in the upper right-hand corner, there's a small box with two tabs, one for visitors, one for members, and you click on it, and you see a different menu based on which box you click. So the welcome message, or the when I say welcome, I mean that their front page message is still the same for both audiences, and that can be promoting, you know, whatever event's going on, but it's very easy to figure out if you're a member or visitor which, you know, selection of menus you want. I thought that was a really clever design. So know your audience. Make sure that your website, you know, casts your vision, or not casts, but communicates the vision and mission of your church, especially, you know, your mission. What is your church about? What is it doing in the community? How is it, you know, moving God's kingdom forward? Communicating that information helps people quickly figure out whether you're a church they want to attend or not. And yes, your mission might turn off some people, but that's great, because they're going to at least remember your website. You know, I checked out this church, it wasn't for us, but, you know, they had a pretty cool website. Or they might see your mission and go, you know, that sounds interesting. Yeah, let's go Sunday and find out if, you know, their walk meets their talk kind of thing. So get that, make sure, you don't have to put your mission statement boldly on the front page, but make sure that your mission, what your church is about, is communicated through the text and pictures of what you're explaining on your website. When I say get a CMS solution, CMS stands for Content Management System. And this gets around the problem we talked about, the tools, whether they're online or offline for building your website. If, again, we've got someone who's using Fireworks or Dreamweaver or PageMill, I don't even know if that's still around or not, but you get tools like that, only that person can maintain that website. And even if you know, they're not using a tool, if they're just, you know, straight coding HTML, then only someone who knows HTML can update your website. But when you get a content management solution, you have a username and password, you log in, you use very word processor-like controls to create text, to create pages, to delete pages, to link them in different ways, and then you log out. So anybody who can use a word processor can now log in and maintain your website. And that's great, because now you can divide up the work of maintaining your content. It's not all on your shoulders. Children's ministry director can update their pages, you know, whenever they want. The youth master can update that. The worship director can put up, you know, the sample songs for this coming Sunday. Everybody can put up their own content. Now, you need to be the air traffic controller to make sure all this content's working together, but that becomes more your role now as a manager rather than the creator of the content.
Is that solution online, or are you saying?
Yeah, the content management solution is online, and that will be dependent upon you know, what usually the hosting company will provide your CMS, but you can also go sometimes to a third party, like that Business East company that I mentioned earlier. They have a CMS tool. They can install it on any host, wherever you want to host, or if you use their hosting solution, they've already got the tools built in and your website gets built that much faster. But, you know, you don't have to use theirs. There's if any of you are familiar with open source software, there's a lot of CMS tools you can install, but that's usually where you need someone with system administrator experience to be able to install those tools on whatever server your website sits on. So, and then, like I said, make sure your content is portable. That goes back to that, you know, please stay away from template sites unless, you know, that's where you're starting at before you build something larger later, or if that's just what your budget allows for. But yeah, just make sure that you can pick up your content and move it, whatever kind of content management solution you go with. And then, even though this isn't website really websites, I thought I'd just throw in some social media stuff here as well. And you know, I felt this when I first got into social media, the idea that you have to be everywhere all at once. You know, you've got to have a Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Google Plus, Flickr, YouTube account. You know, it is a lot of work. I mean, that is a large part of my job, just maintaining all these presences for the EPC. But don't try to start everywhere at once. Figure out where your audience is and go to that place first. If you've got a lot of people around Facebook, start by building a Facebook presence. If you've got people who are really into Pinterest, you know, maybe you've never had any experience, but if a lot of your congregation's using it, then that's where you need to go to communicate information. Start there, and when you get experience with that and you get comfortable with it, then move on to the next thing. And also, it may be that, you know, your church has one presence, but your ministries might have different presences. A lot of youth pastors are on Facebook because high school and college students are on Facebook. At least they are now. I've been reading stuff for the last 6 months. Teenagers are leaving Facebook in droves because, egad, their parents are on Facebook and they keep liking them, which is very much equivalent to your parents coming up and showing your baby pictures to your friends. So it's like, well, if my parents are going to like me on Facebook, I'm going to go leave for Tumblr or Twitter. So, and I just saw that article this morning in USA Today. Yes?
And I think you spin off from that comment about Facebook data is that you may be surprised if you have an older congregation that probably have a lot of members on Facebook and love to get church communication via Facebook. And I was really surprised. So you might be surprised too if you toss that out there.
Yep. Well, and also looking at older congregations, many older people are getting on Facebook, but for many of them, blogging is a great way to get them involved in social media, because blogging is very analogous to a newspaper, which many of them still read. So Facebook, probably because their grandkids are helping them with Facebook, but also blogging is a great place to start with older audiences. Somebody have a question over here? Oh, okay.
How do RSS feeds work?
Okay, RSS feeds. There's a whole bunch of technical stuff I'll just skip over. When you find a blog that has an RSS icon, it's usually a small red square, and it kind of is a dot with some waves radiating out from it, so it's kind of like a radio antenna. For most browsers, when you click on that, a pop-up will display and ask you, how would you like to receive your RSS feed? Would you like to get it by email? Do you want it as a live update in your browser? Or do you have a dedicated news reader that you'd like me to send this information to? Once you select how you want to get your RSS feed, then every time that blog or web page with that feed on it is updated, you will get a notification, hey, there's new information on this page. So if you decide you're going to get your RSS feeds by email, you get an email that says, click this link to see the latest update on this page. You click it and you go to the blog and it takes you there. Or if it appears as a live update in your web browser, like in Firefox, I use that, and what will happen is you open up Firefox and the link will blink at you. So that's how you know that, you know, well, I'm going to click that because something's new there.
So if you're updating your own church website on a regular basis and you had that,
yeah,
every time you updated your website, that would get fed out if anybody was subscribing to it, right?
Yep, exactly. So your church calendar would be a great place to put an RSS feed, because I'm assuming you're going to update your calendar at least once a week, or definitely at least once a month. So that'd be a great place for an RSS feed. Yeah, question in the back.
Good resources you're aware of to help you learn the ins and outs of Facebook, particularly how to design and utilize a church page?
12-year-old. Well, first off, when it comes to any of the social media tools like Facebook, Twitter, Google, Pinterest, I do not recommend getting a book. Because literally, by the time the book hits the stands, it's already 3 to 6 months out of date. And for some of them, like Google Plus, which isn't changing too rapidly, that would be okay. But Facebook just went through a major overhaul here this last February. And that was after their major overhaul, which I think was the previous September. So all I can say is that... I mean, there are some resources. I'm trying to think of them offhand. Good grief. Diosa Communications, D-I-O-S-A Communications. Heather Mansfield, that's her name. Heather Mansfield, she has a lot of good information on Facebook. Just to let you know, if you sign up for any of her free webinars, she has great information. She is really hard to listen to. She is really, and this, I'm recording this too. She has a lot of good information. She has a lot of good information. Let me just focus on that. She has a lot of good information. Heather Mansfield, Diocese Communications. Beth Cantor, she is the queen of nonprofit communications. Church Marketing Sucks is one of my favorite websites for church communications. And I'm trying to think, they have a companion.
Is that a .com or what? Church Marketing Sucks?
Yeah, churchmarketingsucks.com. And they have a companion site, Church Communications Lab, CC. I think that's just churchcommunicationslab.com. It might be cclab.com. That has more technical analysis information, where Church Marketing Sucks is more essay type. Hey, I found this great website, and here's what they did right. Or here's a sample of six websites, and let's see if we can figure out what's wrong in them besides the graphics. Those are all good resources that I can think of. There's plenty more. Those are the ones that come to mind. The only other thing I want to say about social media, and I'm running out of time fast, grab your geolocation sites. And by that mean there are social media sites that really focus on where your organization is located, which, you know, for all of us is a church. These would be Yelp, Foursquare, Facebook Places, Google Maps, things like that, LinkedIn. And the reason I say grab these is because many of these sites, particularly Yelp and LinkedIn, they already have pages for you whether you built them or not. These places are constantly mining Yellow Page ads, postal records, and whatever, and when they find something new, they create a page for it. So rather than just let them say what they think they should be said about you, go in, claim your page. Like with Foursquare, for instance, what will happen is there's a button, you say, you know, claim this page. You click it, and it'll say, what's your email address? It'll send you an email. There's things to follow. One of them is, which is really cool, you click this other link, and it calls you based on the phone number you entered. And there's a number on the website, so you punch the number into the phone to confirms that you're you, and now you get to own your own Foursquare page and make whatever updates you want to it. So it's actually kind of a fun experience. It was a little freaky at first, but I'm like, this is cool. It's calling me on the phone. But anyway, I just want to let you know that these sites are out there, so make sure you grab them. And by the way, if you put your website link in these, that helps boost your website engine rankings. So another good reason to get all these geolocation services figured out. Print materials, real quick. Sunday bulletins and newsletters. The big question I have is with your Sunday bulletins in particular, do they provide information people need for the service, or do they provide information they need for the week? Because that is your typical Sunday bulletin. Here's what's going on today, and here's what's going on for the rest of the week. Pardon me. My recommendation is to separate those two. So now your order of service can become, instead of a very complicated brochure to make for Sunday morning, can become a simple, single page. Here's our order of worship today. And I think you will be surprised, rather than having ushers hand out bulletins to everybody that walks by them, if you have a convenient place, a stand, a table, whatever, for people to pick up the order of worship, I think you'll be surprised how few people actually pick up that sheet of paper. Because most likely your order of service is pretty much like what it was last week, and so as long as they've been coming for a month, they know what they're supposed to do next. Now, your order of service may include, you know, a scripture verse, or maybe you include the words for a song, so maybe that's a good reason to, you know, keep printing that every week. But I think, you know, in terms of reducing the amount of work you have to do in laying the stuff out and the amount of paper you have to print, by separating your calendar from your order of worship, you can reduce a lot of your operating costs and reduce some of the burden on your office staff and volunteers. As far as the calendar information goes, that can be handled again by putting together a monthly calendar or just putting out flyers in appropriate locations in the church. If you want the high school and junior high school group to sign up for something, don't put the brochure in the main lobby because they're not in that service. They're wherever they're at. Go put the sign-up forms there for them. So where I'm kind of going with this is then leading you to a bulletinless service. And we do have some of our congregations that have gone bulletinless. I've spent a bunch of time, in fact, I did one of my webinars, I did a guest interview with two of them. And what they shared with everybody is that, yes, you do save a lot of operating expenses because you've reduced your printing, but you don't save any time because you still have information you have to communicate out, but instead of putting it in a printed piece, now you're putting it in a PowerPoint slide, you're putting it up on the website, you're putting it out through Twitter, these kinds of things. So you won't save any time, but you will get the information to people in a form that they're most looking for it in, because a lot of people aren't looking for information in a printed piece, amazingly. So I went through all my bullet points pretty fast, good. In terms of newsletters, printed versus electronic. I get this question all the time. We're thinking of saving money, should we go electronic? Well, okay, the two ways to handle electronic, number one is use a service like Constant Contact, which costs money, so you're not really saving much money, although you are communicating information in a more efficient manner. Or the other way is to simply put together some kind of email and put together an email distribution list. The downside of using your computer to distribute an email list, number one, if your computer dies for any reason, all of a sudden you've lost your distribution list. And worst case, number two, your computer gets hacked by a virus, and the virus goes, ooh, look at all the email addresses I can now spam and sell to spammers and such. So you're actually doing your members a disservice. So I highly recommend that if you're going to distribute your church newsletter electronically, don't use your computer to do that. Use some third-party service like Constant Contact for distribution. I still like paper as much as I do electronic. Paper's great for a couple reasons. Number one, it has permanency, meaning that I can take this newsletter of great information, I can lay it on this table, and then tomorrow somebody can come by and go, look, yeah, that's a pretty cool newsletter. All right, I'll take that. And so the information's been transferred. The other thing is that I can say, you know, I've got a great article here and I know that you need it, so I'm going to hand it right to you. So it's that easy to transfer. And you might say that email works the same way because it's easy to forward email. Well, first off, I have to be in front of my computer to send the email. You have to be in front of your computer to receive it. And I have to make sure that I didn't do anything to my email that's going to affect your spam filter. But on the other hand, if I'm in Livonia, Michigan, and you're down here in Baton Rouge, it's going to be pretty hard for me to hand you something. So what I'm saying here is, one is neither better than the other. Again, it comes back to look at your audience. How do they want to receive information and meet their needs? If you've got a highly mobile audience that is constantly doing this with their smartphone, then you need to go to an electronic newsletter. But if you've got people who like paper, they like the touch and feel, they put it up on the refrigerator for the whole family to see, then you need to stay with print.
Quick question.
Yes.
We had a tech person tell us that because we do email out all of our announcements and stuff like that, mm-hmm. that you address it to yourself, and you BCC everybody else so that no one can get a reply to all and get it to everybody that was sent to.
Oh, thank you for bringing up the point. That is a very good point. Yes, if you are going to email anything, your newsletter, budget information, you know, whatever you're going to do in a mass communication, make sure you BCC everybody on the list. True story, a church I used to attend when I was in the singles group, I forget, there was some event going on, so I signed up for it. The person communicated the information back to all of us without using BCC, which stands for blind carbon copy, so you can't see the other email addresses. Within a week, I was contacted by three Primerica agents. Since my name is Dana, a Mary Kay cosmetics person, don't use Mary Kay, neither does my wife, a real estate agent, yes. So within a week, I got contacted by five people that I had no interest in having a communication with. So yeah, make sure you use BCC whenever you do use a big distribution. Unless the people who are on the list know each other and have given each other permission to see their addresses. So, like, for instance, the clerks of your session, okay, they all work together for your church. There's no reason for them to BCC messages to each other. They know each other. They're working together, so. And just like a website, you can use, again, this graphic idea to lay out your newsletter if you're getting ready to use a redesign. And again, you can kind of see we've got the nameplate across the top with the, you know, banner for the church. Below that is the kick plate, so you've got your date, your volume and issue number. We've got a headline, some story down in the lower right-hand corner. We've got our table of contents because it's a 8-page newsletter. So see, very quickly you can get an idea of what this newsletter is about, even without seeing any text or pictures. So, yes?
Do you have any suggestions for layout software that's maybe a notch below Adobe Creative, you know, like InDesign?
Oh, okay. The question is there a good layout software for newsletters and bulletins that don't cost huge sums of money like Adobe Creative Suite or Adobe InDesign, which, by the way, if you are going to purchase a high-end program, Adobe InDesign is probably the best one you want to get, because that is what desktop publishers have used ever since it replaced its predecessors, FrameMaker and PageMaker. And I don't even know if Quark Express is still out there or not, but I know that was an expensive program at the time. There is Microsoft Publisher. I've used it. If you are new to desktop publishing, Microsoft Publisher probably would be okay. It's less expensive. I don't like it because it doesn't work the way any other program I've used works. So for me, it's just that I've spent a couple decades using desktop publishing software a particular way. Microsoft Publisher doesn't work that way, so it's an irritant to me. But I'm not saying that makes it a bad program. It's a bad program for me. Microsoft Word can actually be a good desktop publishing tool. If you learn how to use these three things, if you learn how to use columns, styles, and templates, if you learn how to use those three things, you'd be amazed at the kind of great designs you can come up with in Microsoft Word. Now, I'm not saying it's going to be easy, but it won't be incredibly difficult, and it will be a lot less expensive than maybe getting InDesign or Quark Express. If you use open software, there is an open source program. Oh, and what is it called? GIMP is the graphic processor. Inkspace is the vector drawing program. Oh, okay. Do a search on open source, which is two words, open source, DTP. And that'll tell you what that program is, and darn it, you know, it's going to come to me 5 minutes after we're done here. So, but those are the only things I'm aware of. So Microsoft Publisher or this open source tool that I can't think of. Okay, yes, I'm sorry. There are a few Mac people in the audience. I forget you're there. I'm sorry. It's not intentional. It's not intentional. It's just that I don't have a Mac. I don't have friends who have Macs. I don't have an access to a Mac, so I just don't think about it. But
you haven't joined the cult yet.
No, not yet.
Scribus,
thank you. Thank you for doing the search. Scribus. Open source program is Scribus, yes. And I have used it. It is a little quirky to get used to, but once you do, you will like it. It's got all the features you need, and it's free. So it's got the right price tag on it. The vector one was Inkspace. And the last one you'll need in that suite is GIMP, G-I-M-P, the graphical image processor.
Now, just out of curiosity on those,
yeah.
We have a person who is trained in using Publisher.
Okay.
So just so people know that you can't mail it out in Publisher because most people don't have Publisher on their computer, so you have to save it as PDF, and then that goes out. Is that true with all the rest of those as well?
Yep. Exactly. InDesign, Scribus, any of those. Most people don't have those programs, so they won't be able to open the newsletter, but all of those programs export to PDF. So you'll be able to do that. And the nice thing is all of them let you include hyperlinks as well. So if you want to email a newsletter that has a link to your youth ministry's Facebook page or your website or your pastor's blog, you can include those links and then just click on them and go. So that's another nice thing about having the electronic documents versus a print one. We have to type in, and if the URL is really long, that can be frustrating. So, let's see. So anyway, I made it in time. All right. So we talked about volunteers, websites, and print publications. Here are the resources I talked about, and I'm sorry, we're not going to get to the networking part of this. I was going to have you all grouped together, but hopefully during the rest of assembly you'll find each other, look at three or four faces around you, and talk to somebody after business session tonight. EPC Communicator webinars. These are the webinars I do every month except June and July. So I'll be starting these up again in August. These, typically we've been doing them Monday at noon Eastern Standard Time. They're once a month. But if you go to this website, epc.org, EPC Communicator Call-In, there is a survey there. Mark off the times on that survey that you would be available to listen to these webinars. And starting this fall, then, I'm going to reevaluate when is the best time. And that's simply based on whatever the most popular time is that people want to log into these things, that's when I'll do them. So, and frankly, I wouldn't mind moving away from Monday at noon because that's when I eat lunch. So, but if that's where people want to stay, then that's where we'll stay. So anyway, we've got those webinars that are available. I also have them recorded, at least most of them. So if you go to this Vimeo site, the URL there, you can go there and you can hear the recordings of the webinars that we've done in the past. And that covers everything from how to use PowerPoint to create movies to, we did a four-part series this last fall, how to create a church communications plan. We've talked about social media, Facebook in particular, just a whole host of topics. So, that's available for you. And then also epc.socialgo.com. This is the URL for EPC Community. That's our online community. You have to have a login ID for that. It's the access code is EPC1981, and that's case sensitive. So it's capital E, capital P, capital C, 1981. Use that. That'll get you into EPC Community. And there's all kinds of discussions in there. We've got a discussion for church communications, for small churches, for people who want to be authors, for worship leaders, urban ministries, all kinds of stuff to talk about there. So that's another great source where you can go in and talk with other people about church communication issues or other issues. Okay. I'm sorry, what?
Do you need a password to get into those others where you have your...
Oh, no. The communicator call-in is on the EPC site, so there's no password there. Vimeo, there's no password on that either. Just make sure you click the EPC communicator album, because there's a couple other albums for grouping videos. But we get all those in one place, and then the EPC community, that's the only one that requires an access code. The access code is capital E, capital P, capital C, 1981.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sure.
We just subscribed to be able to record, video record our music, as well as our stuff for putting it on the web. Yeah. Do you recommend us having an off-site place to store all of that? Video and then just have it linked? I'm not the technical person to be able to know that because, or what's your suggestion there?
Yeah, especially for video, I recommend getting a third-party service to store your video, whether that's Vimeo has a free service, but you're limited on storage and also you have to wait for things to upload, but you can upgrade that service and be able to upload immediately. Vimeo would be a good place. There's other places, I'm sure, but I can't think of their names right now. But I recommend putting the video off your own server for a couple reasons. Number one, again, you get that backup issue. And the other thing is the bandwidth. Because even though you might have a commercial internet connection at your church, you get 10 or 12 people downloading the same video at the same time, and they're all going to see halts and stutters. Because of the bandwidth, where you get someplace like Vimeo and put your video there. Vimeo does have a buffering issue, but once you start, it starts buffering, it plays along just fine. But there's other commercial services where you can get that bandwidth and not have to worry about all that halting and starting. Yep, in the back there.
Dan, will you put some of the references from your PowerPoint online someplace for us?
Yes. Yep, that's why I'm recording here. Sometime I won't say next week, but sometime soon, I'll take this video and I'll put it with all of these slides and I'll put that on the Vimeo channel, because I had two people ask me who couldn't be at General Assembly if I'd record this, so I'm doing it primarily for them, but for anybody who wants to review this later. Other questions? Okay, yes.
Yes. Just wondering your suggestions for the best way to drive traffic to your site.
The best way to drive traffic to your site. Because there's a lot of ways to drive traffic, but the best way. Well, the best way, in my mind, and this you won't find this in most books or articles, I think the best way to drive traffic is to have content that people want. So you can do all the tricks that everybody recommends about getting your geolocation sites, getting inbound traffic, link it from your Facebook page, that kind of stuff. But if you've got content that people want, then by word of mouth, and that means through email, through phone calls, through whatever, they'll let people know that, hey, if you need information about this, then this church's website is the place to go for that. So that's what I would recommend. And so how do you find out what content do people want? And that's getting to know your audience. Who is your audience? Are you speaking, again, primarily to your church, and who is it in your church that's going online? Or are you speaking to your community, and then who is it in your community that's going online? If you run a lot of counseling center, if you run a lot of counseling services through your church because you've got a community that has a lot of counseling needs, then you want to make sure that you've got that counseling information on there, plus you let people know that their privacy and their dignity are both